Everything old is new again. The wheel of the seasons has turned, and now it is spring. Those of you who have passed many seasons will recognize the difference between winter and spring. It's rather vivid. It is the time of primavera, the first green. The birds, in particular the robins, return. Cardinals. Flowers burst into bloom. There is a fragrance in the air. Pollen, allergies, insects, all sorts of interesting things that we were not very aware of, several months ago, when it was dark and when there was snow. Imagine our ancestors who lived in the north, the northern climes of Europe, Ireland, England, Germany, and what the sense of time must have been to them. How their very survival hinged on the waning of winter and the return of the spring, and how evidence of new life returning, a renewed earth, meant salvation. Salvation in terms of survival. They had survived the long, cold, dark, lonely winter. The storehouses of winter, the grains and whatever meats had been saved up and salted, had been depleted. The dead who had yet to be buried. Now the earth could be broken up and the bodies laid to rest. What a time of poignancy the spring must have represented to those of the north. It is a time of reflection, of rejoicing, of renewal, a time to talk about the regeneration. Further to the south, of course, you had the early Christian movement, which was a spin-off first of Judaism, but heavily influenced by the Egyptian religion. And as the legionaries traveled throughout the empire, they brought other people with them, and they brought their gods and goddesses and their traditions further and further, deeper and deeper into that Roman Empire, further away from Judea. And with each new mile, with each new culture that they encountered, there was an exchange of ideas. And in many instances, they were grafted onto one another. And there were some striking similarities. As I shared with the youth, this time of year is sacred to the pagans, whether they're the Roman or the Druid. It's also, of course, sacred to the Jews and to the Egyptians, all those who live in the Northern Hemisphere, because it is a time that our ancestors, since the earliest age of awareness, have recognized the importance of the return of life. Now, of course, different traditions and different religions have not always coexisted in perfect harmony. The more things change, the more they stay the same. But I think it is very telling that the Egyptian religions were very powerful and very important to the development of early Christianity. For those of you who have studied early religion, you know that the ancient Jews and the ancient Romans and the ancient Greeks had a rather dismal view of the afterlife. You died and you went to this place where you weren't necessarily tormented, but you were alone and lost with all the other souls, if you believed in an afterlife at all. The Egyptians, on the other hand, had a much more powerful tradition that there was an afterlife, and that, yes, folks, you can take it with you. And that's why they buried their royalty and their wealthy dead with all the implements that they should have with them in the afterlife, including small statues, who it was believed represented the souls of the servants who would serve them in the afterlife. And it was a very, very powerful tradition that had an enormous influence on the other local religions. Now, to put things in perspective, imagine that Springfield is the center of the universe. Let us say that the distance between Springfield and Milwaukee is the same distance, roughly speaking, as between Jerusalem and Cairo. It's really not that far, whereas the distance between Jerusalem and Rome would be the same distance as Springfield to Mexico City as the crow flies. Now imagine if you have all these important empires with all their traditions growing up around you. Which one is going to have more influence overall? I would suppose that the one closest to you, in this case, Egypt. But we don't talk much about the Egyptian religion and its influence upon Christianity, because Christianity developed into two main branches, the Greek-speaking branch and the Roman-speaking branch. And the Romans, who had conquered Egypt, had a very poor opinion of the Egyptians. They considered them very effeminate, and they would rather not talk about any influence that the Egyptians had over them. And that particular bias has been handed down through over 2,000 years. And so when we look at the cradle of Christianity, perhaps we will look at what happened in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago, but then we will immediately divert our eyes towards the West and ignore what actually was the reality of what happened 2,000 years ago and the influences there. At Christmas, I talked about the parallels between Osiris and Jesus. And for those of you who recall and are interested in the comparison of religions, you will know that Osiris was a god who suffered, as was Jesus. He had 12 apostles. He was born on December 25th. He was called the King of Kings, the Lamb of God, the Lord of Light. And the parallels include that he raised his friend Lazarus from the dead. There are so many parallels between the Egyptian religion of Osiris and Jesus that it is an embarrassment to Christians to even talk about it. But as Christianity evolved and as it progressed through the Roman Empire, it encountered the religion of Ostara. Ostara, the goddess of the dawn, associated with the spring. She had animals associated with her, the birds of spring, rabbits, new life, eggs. And as Christianity had done with Christmas traditions, it absorbed all these other traditions that had absolutely nothing to do with the Easter as the original Jewish followers of Jesus had understood it. Now, no one can say exactly what happened on that quote-unquote Easter morning in Jerusalem. What we do know is that a demoralized band of followers found a reason to continue. And perhaps they were inspired by the message of Jesus, but perhaps there were those who, like St. Paul, said that if Jesus Christ was not resurrected, then our religion is futile. And so you had a division within the early Christians between those who focused on the message of Jesus and those who focused on the miracles. And as we know, that within a few generations or a few decades of the death of Jesus, the original followers of Jesus were exterminated with all the Jewish inhabitants of Jerusalem and Judea, and that the only people left to testify as to who this Jesus might have been were the followers of Paul, who, unlike the original followers of Jesus, had never encountered him. I find it fascinating to look at the parallels between the Jewish celebration of Passover, Pascua, or Pesach, Easter, or Pascua in the Romance-speaking languages, or Easter in the Germanic English-speaking languages. How there is so much emphasis about the East. In one case, the sun and the dawn. In the other case, the rising of the sun, S-O-N. And how both look to the east. And it occurs to me that throughout the United States this morning, there were many sunrise services. which actually harks back to the very pagan celebration of Ostara, the welcoming of the S-U-N. And so in the pagan tradition, there was a sense of renewal, regeneration. In the Christian tradition, a sense of resurrection, which many people confuse with renewal, but is actually something extremely different. And then the sense of the celebration of the Passover, which is freedom and deliverance. And perhaps that is the common thread that links all three celebrations, the sense of deliverance. And perhaps that was part of the original message where the early ambassadors of Christianity, when they met the ambassadors from the other traditions, found initial common ground, not just in looking to the East, but in that theme of deliverance. Now, they differed as far as who was being delivered from what. In the pagan North, they were being delivered from winter, from death, from hunger. It was survival. For the Christians, it was a sense of deliverance from death and sin. And their notion of death had grown through its connection with the Egyptian religion, and it became a sense of eternal life and how one could be born into this eternal life. And unlike some others who also believed in an eternal life, they infused a sense of judgment. Judgment which you will not find in the Greek or Roman traditions. From their point of view, everyone goes to Hades, unless you happen to be partly divine, in which case you can enjoy the golden palaces of Olympus. And it astounds me how so much of the popular imagination, when you talk about the afterlife, is borrowed directly from the Egyptian or from the Roman conceptions of an afterlife. And how most Christians, when they talk about an afterlife in heaven, have visualized, if they describe it in words, have visualized, will have described for you Olympus. Everything old is new again. But that particular theme of deliverance is what sets this day apart from other days and elevates its stature. Now, you know, of course, those of you who have been Unitarian Universalists from a long time, know that while many of us can celebrate Christmas Eve and talk about the rebirth of each child as a new opportunity for salvation and growth and a gift to the world, that we tend to fumble when it comes to Easter. Because for many of us, especially those of us raised in a Christian tradition, Easter has to be about the risen Christ. But when you study the religions and you realize it actually is such a hybrid of so many different traditions, and it has been since the very beginning, that we do ourselves a disservice to limit ourselves to only one strict conventional orthodox interpretation of what this day has to be about. There are those who would say you must separate the pagan elements from the Christian elements from the Jewish elements and have the pure experience. I would suggest to you that such an experience has never existed in history. It has always been a hybrid. It has always been a confused convergence of all these different traditions, and it's because of that convergence and all of the color and pageantry of all the different religions that it has survived to the present day. If you did not have the Easter Bunny and the eggs and the candy, I would suspect that it would not be very popular today. It might be as powerful as Groundhog Day. But because there has been this happy convergence of all these different traditions, granted in the most impossible, absurd ways that has been handed from one family to the next, we can celebrate Easter. But Easter begs the question, what is life and what is death? Our ancestors had a very clear cyclical notion of time and nature. They understood the seasons, and they named certain days of the week after certain phenomena, such as Monday after the moon, and various northern gods gave their names to Wednesday and Thursday, for example. Again, a blend of different traditions that have been handed down to the present time. But their concept of time began for human beings and for most of nature at the moment of birth. That is when life began. And clearly, when a person drew their last breath, that is when life ended and death began. And some pagans were terrified of death, just as some moderns are. And some consoled themselves and their children that the pet had ran away, or that grandma had left, or that she had gone to heaven or to Valhalla or somewhere, but that we would see them again. And so it became a very comforting story. And every civilization has had a variation of that theme. They've gone on a journey or continued the journey. But don't worry, when we die, we will join them. Now, there are some individuals who take that message so to heart that they've committed suicide. I remember one story when I was in high school. There was a young woman who was so convinced about her faith and about what to experience that she committed suicide in front of her friends so that she could be with God and not have to go through life. And perhaps for our ancestors, life was so cruel and so unjust that many of them did choose suicide. So that certain religions have intervened and said, that you cannot do. That is an affront to God. You just have to grin and bear it and hope for the best. Others look at the concept of time and life and say that there is an existence of souls before you are born. There is this life, and then you have an eternal existence of souls. And some will say that you do go through various mutations and evolutions, and that perhaps you will evolve into something greater than yourself, that you will join with it. Perhaps you will be judged, and all will be resurrected in bodily form. And I look at the different theories which have been offered about what happens after death. And I remember myself as a teenager and how when I began to be aware that people were dying, the father of a friend of mine in high school, how that began my personal journey to find meaning and to unpack whatever truth might exist about life and eternity. And I'm one of those people who did get a copy of the Egyptian Book of the Dead and tried to read it. I did get a copy of Dr. Raymond Moody's book, Life After Life, which tells the story about the passages of death and seeing a great light and all kinds of images, which have become very popular over the last 30 years in the popular imagination. And I realize I cannot tell you that there is an afterlife. I cannot tell you that there is not an afterlife. I know that of all the various schemes that I have encountered, I think reincarnation is the most elegant, but just because something is elegant doesn't make it true. So we will live and we will die, and then we'll see, or maybe we won't. But it occurs to me that our ancestors, whether they were Christian or Jewish or pagan, lived in very cruel times. They were hungry. They were cold. People died without explanations. There were terrors in the night, including comets. Those who lived in empires often lived at the mercy and whims of emperors and kings who at times could be insane and cruel, and that they thirsted for deliverance and they thirsted for justice, and that thirst for justice and deliverance fed many of the myths which have evolved over the millennia about an afterlife and a judge and a kingdom to come. So what is the point of Easter in this 21st century to a non-believer such as myself? It is a reminder that we are human, that there are limits on what we know and what we do not know. It is a reminder that We did not spring into existence, to use that happy word, spring, but we are the product of generations long forgotten of ancestors who passed down not only genetic material, but also their stories, their prejudices, their hopes, and their dreams. And that we are all, individually and collectively, one incredibly complex blended family. And that these things can coexist side by side. And that we do not need to remove certain elements that we deem offensive. Because, as I said before, they've always been interwoven. And so, as someone who used to scowl at Easter and scowl at Christmas, I'm here to tell you that I can enjoy such a holiday. And I can enjoy the confusion of the words resurrection with renewal, with rebirth and reunion, and not take offense or not try to browbeat others and to convince them that it must be understood in such a way. And I will delight in the return of Bream and the Robins, and yes, even the Cardinals. I will delight in the jelly beans and the chocolate bunnies. And I will pack an Easter basket, actually I did that this morning, and hide it for Celeste so that she can also go through that ancient tradition of looking for the hidden eggs and goodies. And I worry about Celeste and other of her generation that we raise, those who understand that these things are made up and that they're myths, as one of the children mentioned, but get them to appreciate the larger truth inherent in some of these stories, in some of these traditions. And just because it's not factually true doesn't mean that you need to discard it, like so much rubbish during spring cleaning. All is recycled, and everything old is new again. And I hope that for us and for the generations to come, that they will continue to live and to delight in all the confusion, the colorful confusion, but also all the richness of these religions that have been passed down unto us. So may it be.